What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Jesse Warden here. Today we're going to talk about a beginner's guide to functional programming. I'm writing a book and I wanted to test some material, and I also wanted to give young people a better impression of functional programming, an easier time of what's important to focus on because it's a large subject. Rather than going deep in, getting very disappointed and frustrated, very similar to what I did, taking a long time and not really seeing the benefits, I want the opposite to happen. I want you to see the benefits. I want you to invest a lot less time and have it valuable to your real world work today. Programming, gaming, fitness, Jesse Warden. Welcome to Functional Programming, a Beginner's Guide. We're going to talk about the why first, because anytime you're learning something new and it's hard and there's challenges and you get frustrated, you need to have a justification as to why you're doing this. What is the end goal? What keeps you motivated? What keeps you going? And going to talk briefly a little bit about what's real world versus academia when we talk about functional programming. So the elevator pitch for me that I've found from just day to day, not even being an expert at it, and it still helps me out a lot, is I don't have any mocks in my tests. So stubs can still be pretty verbose, but you don't have to do mocking behavior. Mocks tend to be made specifically for testing side effects. That's what they're built for. And so you don't need those in your unit test anymore. And that's nice because stubs are a little bit easier to follow. They're basically functions that always return the same value or data that's always the same. And so that kind of determinism and determinability is a little bit easier to read, whereas mocks, you call one thing and test that it called something else. No null pointer exceptions or no errors in general is an extremely, really nice thing that I can't get enough of. I like when I write code and it doesn't blow up, right? No stack traces. So that kind of stuff is significantly helpful. Now, you can still use the stack traces in the errors you get, but you won't actually have your program crash, which is nice. Easier to create concurrency, so if you have a bunch of pure functions that can be run concurrently because they don't have any global state, it's really easy to run one or 500. It doesn't matter. The code itself, because it's the same input, same output, is a lot easier to cache. You can guarantee that if you get the same inputs, there's no reason to run the code again. You can just give the same output. So caching is a lot easier. And there's no need, especially in JavaScript and Python, there's no need to memorize stupid this or self rules. You don't have to memorize the prototype and the class and bind and all this other junk because you don't have to worry about it anymore. So you still should learn it. You still should try to know as much as you can because you're going to be dealing with code. But from a functional programming perspective, that kind of stuff is just not anything you need to worry about, which is kind of nice. Creating functions that are truly reusable. And what that means is the functions you write can be teased apart a lot easier than a lot of OO code bases that have those dependencies there. You still have dependencies, you still have things that are tied together, but the functions themselves are a lot smaller, and so those individual pieces are a lot easier to reuse. And lastly, you don't have to worry about inheritance or composition. There's no such thing. You can do compose, where you put functions inside of other functions, but that OOP thing of inheritance and composition, none of that stuff matters. So the downside, the caveats to that, is the stubs really only match your implementation. So you need integration tests. You still, if you fake a server, you still have to eventually test the server, right? You have to do contract tests. You have to do black box tests, that kind of stuff. Especially in JavaScript and Python, where a lot of the code is third-party libraries, those libraries do throw errors. And so working with them, there's no guarantee that your stuff won't throw because you consume them. And we talk about cap theorem from a distributed computing perspective. Cap theorem is really hard to debug, thus there's tools like TLA Plus out there to do the math for you on what are the eventualities where things could break. So just because it's easier to do concurrency with functional programming doesn't make it necessarily any easier to debug it and predict it and test it and things like that. Also, everyone uses this and classes, at least some OOP, object-oriented programming in JavaScript and Python and Lua. So you can't escape it. Just because you're using functional programming doesn't mean you're going to not work with people who just continue to use OOP, for example. An imperative runs everything. Your make files, your shell files, your build scripts, your Jenkins, all that stuff that builds your code. You're not going to rewrite all of that in functional programming. So imperative is going to be around for a long, long time, but your code can be functional. And this is obviously a straw man kind of argument where we basically make OOP look as bad as possible. But even without types, simply adding an item in a class-based language requires a class and an instance and some kind of method. If you're using some of the newer ones, you can use a class that just has static methods. But at the end of the day, functional programming is about functions. Functions are just that, really small in languages like Python and JavaScript and somewhat in Lua. And so having that less code means less overhead, easier to read, easier to understand. And when you start composing programs with that, it makes it a little bit easier to digest. So that's the selling points. That's why we're doing it. And we talk about real world versus academia. We just mean that whatever we're learning today, you can use in your real world projects rather than for some academic reason. So part of the solution, not part of the problem. Functional programming creates deterministic or code that always works. And the things that make it break are the state. And so if you can focus on what you're good at and what you know works is the functional part, then you can spend more time on dealing with the state part. It's the part that's hard. So what we're going to cover today is pure functions, what's not allowed after you learn those things, lenses, which are only really applicable to dynamic languages like JavaScript, Python, Lua, Ruby, things like that. A lot of type languages in functional programming, you don't need lenses. List comprehensions or array comprehensions. Going to touch a lot on curry and partial applications. A little bit about unit testing. I spread it around, not too much, but just remember the unit testing part is that no mocks. And it's all applicable to dynamic languages that you could do today. So what we're not going to cover is category theory. If you wonder, what's the justification for category theory? Imagine if every single piece of code had the same interface. If you know interfaces from Java or C#, imagine if everything had the same interface. Very similar to how everything's an object in some languages. If everything had the same interface and you could mathematically prove it worked, that's what category offers. So category theory is great from a math perspective and an academic perspective and from a program perspective, but we're not going to cover that. You do not have to learn that to gain the benefits of functional programming. So I'm not going to cover it in this today. In types, we're not going to cover anything around types. If you want typed functional programming languages, you can use Elm for the front end, PureScript for the front and back. If you know C# in the .NET world, F# is a really easy, from what I've heard, jump from there, beautiful language. Scala, which isn't listed here if you're a Java person, and Haskell, which is one of the main ones from a typed perspective. And we're not going to cover Henley Milner from the typed. If you read Dr. Bullion, also known as Professor Frisbee, he's got a really good set of videos on egghead.io, and he's got a free book online that you can read all about Henley Milner. Henley Milner is a wonderful type system to describe those functions, but it's used in type languages mainly. So there are dynamic runtime libraries for it, but I'm not going to cover either of these today. But I encourage you definitely, when you have time, to go read about these subjects. If you forget everything from this presentation, that's fine. I just want you to remember the rules and the power behind pure functions. You learn this, and you will save so much time learning everything else. This is what I had wish I had learned first and understood and grokked the importance of this. It seems so simple and so benign, but pure functions really are the core key quantum elements of everything in functional programming. And so it's very imperative that you understand the two rules and how they work and how you break them. Once you understand this, then you can use them as a gateway to learn everything else. The two rules for pure functions are same input, same output, no side effects. So what do we mean by that? By same input, we mean the arguments or parameters in the function. So A and B in this case, or no arguments, or a ton of arguments. That's the input. When we talk about functions taking inputs, that's what we mean by input. Same output. Most functions in OOP code bases don't always return a value beyond the constructor. You'll call a method to refresh something or make a database call, and they're known to modify something in the class, where in this case, we're saying functions actually return values. And so if we have this input, we expect this output. And every time we call it, if we call it three times, it should always work. So those two kind of go hand in hand, but we separate them because they refer to different parts. The second rule, listed as number three, is the third part here, is called no side effects. And that means that whatever happens outside does not affect internally the function of how it operates, as well as when the function's done, it doesn't affect the outside world. So let's break those down to show you some examples, specifically around same input, same output. If we have this function called add, and it takes an A and a B, and we add A and B together, plus this data, data defaults to zero. So if we add one and two here, you can see we call it three times and it follows the same input, same output rule, right? But as soon as we change data, it suddenly changes the output. So we have the same inputs, but not the same output. So this is what we mean by breaking the rule. The rule has clearly been broken here because simply by changing something outside, we've affected what happens inside the function. And so same input, same output no longer happens. So the solution is to ignore the outside world. That is the biggest change in thinking that I had to make as an object-oriented programmer, and even imperative, where you use global variables all over the place, is that you have to ignore the outside world. Nothing matters unless it came from the function arguments, which is a massively hard thing to swallow because a lot of you may be aware now of how many arguments you might have to start using for the dependencies you need. So the way we ignore the outside world in this is simply just remove the variable. It seems simple, but it really is that simple. You just don't put it in there. And if you don't have a variable inside your function, then it doesn't matter what you change data to, because then it'll always have same input, same output. And it's not affected by things from the outside world. So when we talk about outside effects, you saw a little bit of that. Let's talk about somebody who needs an outside effect. The data was optional in that one. In this one, he needs the friend. This function is cow will return true or false if the friend is a cow. If it's some other animal, it's not going to return true. This friend is used via a closure. It's a very similar way to do a safe global in JavaScript that's kind of supports privacy. So you can see at the bottom, even with no inputs, we always have the same output. But watch what happens when we change the friend variable midstream to a chicken, and then suddenly it's always returning false. So even with no outputs, which is considered a type of input, we get a different output. And so outside effects, variables outside of the function can do it. Now in this case, this function, if you notice, it can't ignore the outside world. It needs that friend variable. So what do? You pass in the outside world through the function arguments. And that is how you get the outside world, which has things you need, into your world to be safe in the function. So you pass it in through the argument. So in our case, we pass in the friend argument as the first parameter and only parameter to isCowPure. He can then detect and work the exact same way. She's referencing the variable you pass in through the parameters rather than a global closure. Now, when we change it, it doesn't matter what we do to the outside world. It doesn't matter because we're passing it in. And you could even pass in the friend instead of just hard coding the cow there, and that would work too. So same input, same output, not affected by the outside world. So let's talk about the inside world and affecting the world when the function is done. That's what we mean by inside effects. So here we have a variable. It's a person, age 18. And when a person has a birthday, in theory, they age a year. And by aging a year, we increment their age by one. So in this case, we're taking that person object, taking its age, and adding a one to it. So now the person is going to be 19. We then return that back. So same input, same output. Let's test it out. Now, a couple of problems are happening here. If we pass in this person, you'll notice that the same input is not always the same output because it's mutating the data. So although we didn't change the person variable, the person itself is being mutated and thus changing the same input, same output rule. And this is because it affects the outside world when it is done. And it affects it by mutating that person variable. So it changes the data over time. When we say the word mutate, we mean changing or setting a variable to a different value than it was previously. What's interesting is that you can see it satisfies the same input, same output rule if we pass in the same variable. But what we don't recognize is that it's actually mutating that data. And that's where we get the actual return value from it to verify that it's being mutated. So this is another thing of outside effects and inside effects, where the inside of the function affects the outside world instead of the outside world affecting the inside of the function. So the solution there is not to mutate data. That's how you solve the outside effects problem. If you use immutable data, you don't have to worry about affecting the outside world. Just basically don't mutate anything. If you treat everything as immutable, then there's no way to set variables, and then therefore there's no way to affect the outside world by creating side effects. Side effects mean outside of effects from your function. So here's an example where we take that object and we use a basic way of cloning it in JavaScript, where we get the same object. We just change the properties we care about. In this case, we want to change the age to that plus one. So we're not mutating the person object. We're literally creating a brand new object by doing the dot, dot, dot person. We're cloning the entire thing. We're just changing the age to be different. That's it. And so this immutability works great. And so now we get the same input, same output. And you'll notice that the person variable itself never changes. We haven't changed the outside world. There are no outside effects. And it's not affected by outside effects because we can pass in that person object. The joke, which so far no one found was funny, was you put in the stormtrooper clone, what really happens? Is it a clone of a clone? Now that you know what pure functions are, and you know about same input, same output, no side effects, let's talk about things that are no longer allowed, at least in JavaScript, specifically because you know these rules and they're not pure. Now, when I say not allowed, I just mean they're not pure and you should try to avoid them if you want to be pure. You can still use them. You may have to use them. You may have to work around them. And that's fine. You can always wrap state. Our whole job is to wrap state as programmers anyway. So the quick ones, there's a lot more, but the quick ones are function declarations and expressions. And those are extremely dangerous because they're gateway drugs to this arguments, to the arguments global object, to new target if you're dealing with OOP and low-level class things. using default arguments, even in functions, even if you're not using with classes. Default arguments kind of violate Curry, and they provide the ability to have different inputs based on those arguments, even though they're kind of included as a default of undefined. I'll explain that in a bit. Classes, which encapsulate state. And I mean, to be fair, you're never going to avoid or escape state. Pixels that you're viewing right now on the screen are mutable. They change colors to what you're viewing on the screen. So you'll never have an immutable pixel, right? You're not going to create brand new pixels over time. And so classes are really, really great, especially in UI development, for encapsulating that. But if you want to be pure, you don't want to use classes. And I can show you ways to do UI development without them. And throw. You shouldn't throw errors. Errors are one of the worst side effects, because not only do they break the function and not really have a return value, but they can break other functions such as promises or even node processes where you're running concurrently, where they cause side effects because something broke. So you shouldn't use throw. You shouldn't ever intentionally throw an error, ever. You should follow what Go and Lua does with pcall and just return the error from the function. Variables, can't use those anymore. So don't use let. I know it's better than var, but don't use var. Don't use let. Just use const. And even const is dangerous because you can mutate that. So you can create a constant array and then start pushing in the array. Don't do that either. So when we talk about function declarations, we mean the guy at the top. When we talk about function expressions, we mean the function at the bottom that's assigned to a variable. Both of these have this. Both of these have arguments and things we don't want to use anymore from an OOP context. Because classes are syntax sugar on top of these things, you can literally go new, get data yo, and you have a new class. And this is what I mean by all the this rules, all the class rules that you have to memorize. This is not fun. It used to be fun. A lot of people get off on this, learning every single possible rule, possible error, why it works that way. And they'll put these in interviews questions. So should you be aware of this stuff? Sure. Should you stress about it in an interview? Sure, fine. But my two pieces of advice, don't go to tech interviews. Find a way to network to avoid those. Number two, this kind of stuff doesn't apply to functional programming at all. You're not doing state. You're not dealing with any of this. So this is the kind of stuff you get to avoid, which is great. And we talk about arguments. Arguments are not bad. They're just dangerous because they violate the ability to do Curry and really simple creation of partial applications. And they may or may not get you in trouble for same input, same output, and breaking purity of your function. So while although rest parameters are useful, you're better off in those situations creating a 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, things like that. And we talk about classes, all kinds of side effects. For example, button is all its functions aren't pure because it extends React components. So if that implementation changes, then you've been affected by asset effects, your function methods. The constructor calls a super, and so it completely changes the behavior based on if you call the super or not, if you pass certain variables in the super constructor call. This, we're using this all over the place. So we're setting an outside of effect intentionally, whereas in pure functions, it's not allowed. In this case, it's completely encouraged to set state outside of yourself in a function call. Notice there is no return value, although a constructor will return if you do new. Most class functions don't. They don't return values. And so you can see a lot of reasons why classes are just completely in violation of the two rules of pure functions. Don't throw errors. Bad news. We already talked about that. Don't use var. Don't use let. Don't use const is okay. It's good. It's not great. All right. So now that you understand pure functions, the rules around same input, same output, and you understand what not to use, let's talk about lenses, because they help, at least in dynamic languages, they're kind of an anti-pattern in type languages. They allow you to safely get data, allow you to safely set it, and you can use lenses to focus on those kind of things. So if you think of a lens, the metaphor is kind of steampunk, where you have a lens, you focus on a particular part of an object tree and modify it. Either look at it by getting the data or setting the data, but doing it in a functional, immutable way. And you can do it repeatedly with a lot of these reusable functions using lenses. So we're gonna talk about the trouble with dots first. That way you understand why are we using get, why are we using set, and why are we using lens from Ramda. So here's a person. It's basically me with some deeply nested properties to illustrate how hard it is to do these kind of things. So if you look at person at the very bottom, we can log out the person dot first name, and dots allow you to dot or dot dot your way to object properties. In the case of arrays, you can use the indice operator. And so far, it's a very easy way to access properties in a lot of languages. Dots are a very, very common way of doing things. But what happens
when you misspell the name. So person.fistname is undefined because I meant to say first name, but I forgot the R, so it's undefined. So this is okay. It's okay to mess up the spelling of the name, but it is not okay to mess up the spelling of the variable. So you notice the second one, person, like how the Southerners say it, it's missing the O. And what that means is it's going to throw a reference error because we are trying to dot something that doesn't even exist. That code, once it's evaluated, will break. We get a type error when you misspell home because you've dot all the way down. And once you dot something that's undefined, you start getting runtime exceptions as well for type errors. And so these are common things where you misspell things, and we can't fix number two, where you misspell the variable, but the other two, we can make sure that they never throw errors. They always are guaranteed to always work, to never throw errors, no matter how bad you misspell something, how wrong you get the path, or if you spelled it correct, but you're loading that data from a text file or some third-party website, and it completely changed the API on you. We can guarantee that that won't throw errors. And so this is the key for using pure functions to get and set data. And this is what dots completely sabotage. This is why you don't want to use dots. The way you solve it to get the data, and the examples we showed in the Safeway, is use a get function. It's not a getter function like an OOP. It's a get function. And so you can create these yourself. You basically create a function that says, look, if the person's there, cool. Go ahead and return it. And assuming you didn't misspell first name, it'll work. Otherwise, it'll give you undefined. Or first name is undefined to give you that, but both are safe, and that's okay. And if you unit test it, you can guarantee same input, same output, and no side effects. But Lodash has a get method, and I'm going to use the Lodash one here. Later on, I'll use the Lodash FP, which is a more functional way when the arguments are reversed. So Lodash get allows you to say, look, I need from this person object, I want to get this property. And if it's there and has a value, it'll give it to you. If it's there and it doesn't have a value, it'll give you undefined. In the case of person.fistname, for the example number two. But notice that in the bottom, we say, yo, undefined, get first name, and it gives you undefined. So both of those rules of doing a dot on undefined or misspelling the property name or misspelling the variable name, you're all good because in that case, it'll give you undefined back. It won't throw an error. Now, if I were to type in PR without the O, person, that would still break there. And so this is a safe way. Get is yet another pure function that Lodash offers. Same input, same output, no side effect. When you're doing dot dots, things get a little difficult. There is a proposal in JavaScript at the time of this video for a null access operator. Java has it, Dart has it, TypeScript, I believe, has it as well. And so they're trying to get it in native JavaScript. But for now, you've got to go person and person address and person.address home. If all of those are good, then you can return to dot dots. Otherwise, it's turn undefined. But even this is dangerous because of a lot of the duplication. So the easier way is to use get again and just put the address in there. And so that way you don't have to do dot dot. You let it handle for you. It's a pure function and you're good to go. It gets even worse with arrays because arrays are a different data type than objects. And so you have to check if it's an array first, then use the array index operator, or you could just use get. So again, a lot easier to type, a lot safer, and it's a pure function. When we talk about default value, sometimes you want to know, like, look, if it's undefined, that's okay. I want you to use a default value, or if I try to read it and I can't, I got to go another route. And so that forces you to inspect the return value and then have some logic on that. This is such a common pattern by looking for something, if it's not there and it's undefined, providing default value, that they have a get or. So a get or basically says, look, here's my default value. I'm going to go to devserver.com/email. And sometimes it could be localhost, whatever. I want you to look for the services.email property path on this configuration object. If it's undefined, go ahead and use my default. But if it's not, give me what you found. And so that way you can do it in one line of code. It's a pure function, same input, same output, and you don't have to do if statements and check around for things like that. That's how we get things. How do we set things? The most common and easy way in an imperative style of coding is to say person.firstname equals the new value. Or if it has no value, you set it. So you actually create it in one step. How do you do this from a functional perspective? One way is to use a set function, and it's not a setter function like an OOP. It's actually a function that sets the data in a mutable way. So doing it ourselves, we literally just do what we did before. We use an object, we copy all the properties from person. We just change first name to be the new value that we want. So it'll copy everything, but it'll make first name on your new object, whatever value you want, and it won't modify the person object at all. It literally creates a copy. You can verify that if you log it out the property, you then call your set function, that it doesn't have any outside effects. You can verify that you're using immutable data and you're good to go. But it becomes very common that you can use the set function to do the same thing. And you get past all the other problems you'd have in the same world where you have to do the if and the if property dot if and the and and blah, blah, blah. Digging all the way down, checking for arrays. All the same problems you have in Git are solved using set the same way, with the addition that it doesn't mutate the data. So if you set person, it's going to give you a brand new person object back with just the phone number changed in the first indice of array. So set's very, very, very cool function. Lenses and Rhonda are very similar to Git and set, except they take the Git function and basically make it into two functions instead of one, very similar to set as well. And so you basically do a lens prop, which is very similar to a Git prop. And then you can view or focus using that lens on a particular section of that person, and you view it. So you say view with this lens, the person. The lens is looking for that particular property, which is the first name. And same thing for paths. If you're going dot, dot, you actually pass in an array. So you use lens prop. If it's just one property, you use lens path. If it's multiple properties, instead of doing a dot, dot, you actually pass in an array. But same concept. The difference, though, with lenses, even though the set looks familiar, is when you want to start looping over items. So here we're going to say, look, on the names lens, I want a lowercase and whatever that value is through this function, and then give me the return of that. So this is just modifying one of those values and giving you that cloned value of the immutable data back. But a lot of times you're doing this on arrays of objects and lots of records of objects. And so reusing these functions of functions on functions, they're all pure, they're all deterministic, they all are guaranteed to work and not throw errors. You can start building really, really pure loops that focus in on dynamic data and guarantee that no matter what changes underneath, they're not going to fail, which is a really nice feature. The conclusions on lenses is if you want to safely get data, use get, don't use dots. If you want to safely set data with no side effects, that you've got to use immutability. And to support that, it's easier to use a set function rather than write all that stuff yourself and mess it up. Now, to safely set that data in a more composable way, when you're going to loop over a lot of things, that's where you want to whip out the lens functions from Rhonda. So you understand pure functions, you understand the rules and why we're doing it. We want code that's deterministic, that always works. Avoid all those bad things. And one of the bad things we didn't really talk about was loops. So if we want to support pure functions, we can't really use the existing loops we do. And loops are used all over the place in programming. Arrays are a big, big, big part of a lot of what we do in front-end and back-end development, in taking a list of things, showing them to a user, looping through them. And so how do you do that in a pure way? In Go version 1, they don't have generics, and so it becomes very, very difficult to basically wrap all your loops with certain typed values to guarantee that they're pure, and it's very, very frustrating. But in languages that are dynamic, that support generics or objects, you can basically put whatever you want. That's cool, except that purity is on you to do that loop, and a lot of loops have bad things in them. When people say the word list comprehensions or array comprehensions, what they mean is that their loops are pure. We're gonna talk about the big three. The big three, just like the big three in powerlifting is squat, the bench press, and deadlift. And the big three in list comprehensions are map, filter, and reduce. And every other list comprehension kind of sometimes is built on top of these three. If you understand these big three, these main three list comprehensions, almost every other one is derivative kind of that work. You can actually ignore and not even worry about memorizing the other ones. As long as you know what map and filter do, you're good. Reduce is hard, and that's okay. We're going to parse some data. This is a very, very common thing to get from libraries such as Postgres or Oracle. When you're using dynamic libraries, instead of giving the JSON records with a lot of duplication, the JSON can get quite large. What they do is they give you the raw data in arrays, and then they give you the columns as a separate object, assuming they don't change. Relational database that has set amount of columns, and then just give you row after row after row. Here's an example where we have the rows, and we've got to parse them back with known columns. We want these arrays of strings to be our person object, just like we had before. First name, last name, address, phone number, type. We've got two people and one dog. So using a for loop to do that, we'd loop through the array, and we'd use a for loop here, and that I could be a var or let, doesn't really matter. Although we're trying to use constant a couple places, there's mutation all over the place. First off, we're doing a people fields dot length, right? That's problem number one. We're also taking this I value and incrementing over and over and over. Secondly, we're mutating data. So we're taking the original array of people fields and replacing our parse version in there. You'll notice the fields array indice of 0 or 1 or 2 or 3. We're using that rather than using the get function or the set function. That's very, very dangerous. There's a lot of nasty things going on in this for loop. You can create pure functions using traditional loops. The challenge is that what you do internally still has to be pure, and it's just hard. This problem's already been solved. They use list comprehensions in Ruby, they use them in Python, they use them in everywhere in Lodash. JavaScript's got a lot of these built into the array object now. If you run it, it works. Great. You've parsed out your strings of objects to all the column names of name and address and street and phone and blah, blah, blah. Utilize the array comprehensions built into JavaScript to make it a little bit more pure and a little bit less verbose, right? You literally just create a function. You give it the fields, the index of the array that we're dealing with, and the array itself, and it'll give you an object out. But you're still mutating data, the array index there, and that's why for each is kind of the one list comprehension you don't want to use. And we're still doing axis of arrays for fields, blah, blah, blah. Bad stuff. It works too, but it's not pure. So the solution to solve all the purity problems is to use a pure loop function that takes a pure function to run on each item and return the result. In our for each example, it's not a pure function, but it does run this mutate array to person on each and every item in the array. So this mutate array to person function runs 3 times. Each time it runs, the only thing that's different, theoretically, is the index. The index is 0, 1, and 2. Now, the array is unfortunately different because we're mutating it each time. In a maps case, 3 things go in, 3 new things come out. When we talk about array to person, we take another function, very similar to for each, to make it pure. We're going to take an array, and we're going to spit back out an object. Now, this is kind of pure. We're still violating the array access, but we'll get to him in a minute. If I give you an array, I want you to give me back an object. So this is a nice function to parse one of those items. So if we test it out, we give it the first item. You can see it, cool, it gives us our object. So far, so good. Same input, same output, no side effects. Map is expecting that with the array. So map, 2 parameters from Lodash. It says, give me the array and give me the predicate to run on each item. And it'll give you the array out, but it won't mutate it. It'll actually give you a brand new array with whatever your functions return. So if it runs 3 times, it'll give you an array with those 3 new items of what array to person sent back. And since hopefully it's pure and immutable, you're going to get a brand new array with immutable data in it. So you don't have to worry about modifying the original array. It works just like the others. But the difference is, just like for each, very, very little code here for the for each, right? Just like map, same thing. You have your predicate function, and then you put it in the map. And if you want to, you can define it inline as well. So up here we have names. Notice I'm going to make them all uppercase. I actually define a function in the second parameter of map. I say, go ahead. Whenever I get a name, I want you to return name to uppercase. Every item in the array is a string name. When you put the names in, it's going to spit out an array of strings wherever your name is uppercase. The names array up top is completely different than what map returns. And you can do it like I do on the bottom where you have uppercase. That's fine too. Some of these predicates aren't that simple. And sometimes you may want to separate them out for unit testing purposes, and that's cool. Now, we've talked briefly about lenses, about object access, but we really kind of glazed over arrays because Git works for that. And that's true, but there's another way to use it for just arrays. If you do an undefined array access of 3, it's going to throw a type error. And that's just like if you do the trouble with dots. So the way you solve that is with int. And it's very similar to Git, but it works specifically for arrays. So if I say, give me the index of 3 for this guy, it's going to give me quattro. If I do it for undefined, it gives me undefined. And so it's a pure function, same input, same output, with no side effects. That works specifically for getting data inside of arrays. So we can modify our existing array person in the map function, be even more pure by using int. And now it's a lot more pure. Same indices, just using a pure function instead of doing the dangerous array accessing. Filter is a little different. Filter says, I only need 2 of the 3 things I get in there. I want to get all the humans out of the list. One of them is a dog. The way you normally do that in a filter is you start with a fresh array at the top, in this case called filtered. If the person has a type of human, then we're going to go ahead and add it to the filtered array. Otherwise, we're not going to do anything, which means it basically throws that data to the wind. It doesn't include it into the filtered array. To run that, it's going to run 3 times, but it's not going to include Albus, who's the dog, into the filtered array. When you're done and you console.log filtered, you're going to get those 2 items, those 2 objects printed out on the bottom. And that's fine, but again, for loops, mutation, state, dangerous access of objects, blah, 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 bad stuff. Solution for filter, 3 things go in, only the things you want come out. What do you want? Whatever that function you pass in says true, it'll keep. If you say false, it's not going to keep it. So in our case, type is human is that function to answer the question. If the item type or the person type is of human, keep it. Item type equals human is going to return true for Brandy and Jesse. It's going to return false for Albus. In filter, you see at the bottom here, filter, the first thing is the group of those people. The second parameter is the predicate function. In this case, it's true or false. We call it predicate because a predicate is a function that always returns true or false. Not true, false, undefined, null, or error. Right? It's just true or false. When you log it out, you can see it gets the humans out. We can make it even more pure by, instead of going item.type, we actually get, using the get function there to guarantee it's a super, super safe function. And it's still a predicate, always going to turn true or false, but it's a safer predicate. It won't say true or false or throw type error because item is undefined. If we were to put an undefined in one of those arrays, it would blow up. Now it won't do that. A reduce is hard. It's hard to remember because people think of accumulation in an imperative mindset. I've trained my brain for like 15 years to think in for loops, to remember variables in between loops, and reduce kind of throws that concept out the window and says, I'll handle it from here. It's hard to remember, especially without types or IntelliSense, to remember the order of operations. There's really two things you got to remember with reduce. The first is it takes three parameters instead of two. And the second is that the predicate function that you pass in there takes two parameters. It gives you the accumulator of what it's accumulated up to this point first, and then your data. And then whatever you return, it'll keep adding to that accumulator. So those kind of things are hard to remember. You only get better with practice. We have a slightly different array. We have a bunch of party members for a game here. We have me, Her Majesty, and the dog. And all of them have hit point properties, and they have a class property. And everyone's injured, except for Brandy. We want to print out on the screen who they are and their hit points in kind of like a game style, whether you're doing graphics or just doing text-based. In this case, we're just doing text-based. If you look at the bottom, we're tabbing it. We have the hit points and the max hit points to the right. And we just use the slash to denote, you know, the current and the max. The normal for loop way is you create a string that's empty by default, and you just keep adding to it. So if you see the summary plus equals, that's how you add in place to an existing variable. The purists say you should do summary equals summary plus, whatever. You're still mutating data, so I don't really care. It's not pure. And so if you want to mutate data, that's how you do it. If you're going to do mutate data, why not do it with style? Do it really with less code. So that's why I like doing it this way. But the problem is this is not pure. It's accessing things, doing the normal loop. But the point I want you to remember from this function is that summary is used inside the loop to remember how much of the text you've added. I've added Jesse in a dash in 20/22. The next iteration, it's going to add that text to it. So it's going to add Brandy and her hit points to that big old string. You have this nice formatted thing you have on the bottom, okay? So reduce is going to take over that summary part for you, that state of mutation for you. If we're going to use it to reduce, we'd add member to summary, which basically takes the string and the member and returns the string. But notice that we put the summary in the front. Whatever you put in this template string to the right is just going to add to the summary. So it keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger, unless the summary itself isn't any bigger. Same input, same output, no set effects. Who manages the state of summary? Who's the one who does that? Well, that's the reduce function. If you look at the bottom there in the middle, it says reduce. First parameter is the party, obviously, the array. The second is that add member to summary. The third parameter is the starting value. So in the for loop, it was an empty string that was a variable. In our case, it's literally just an input to a function. So that third parameter is reduce will remember that for you. So whatever you return from add memory to summary, it'll add to that string, and then it'll give it to the next time it calls the function for the next item in the array. And so when we print it out, it does the same thing. Well, let's talk about every, and I don't know if we have time to go some, but every is yet another loose comprehension, where it's a higher level version of these low-level big three. You basically want to say, look, does every item in this array return true for this function? If yes, we're good to go. And you use it a lot for validation. The opposite is sum. Like, does at least one of them return true? In this case, we want to determine, is everyone healthy? And we can very quickly look that Jesse and Albus are not. Their hit points are lower than their max hit points. So they're not healthy. The only person who is Brandy. This function that we're going to create to determine if a member is healthy or not is going to return false for Jesse and Albus and true for Brandy. We want to know if every single one returns true. Now, in a for loop way, you'd set a variable or flag, a Boolean flag as they call it, and you'd either switch it on or switch it off based on some kind of criteria. In our case, as soon as one person is considered unhealthy, we set it to false. And that way at the bottom, when the loop is done, we can say, look, dude, it started off as true, but if one member triggers it, we don't really care. We could literally stop the loop at this point. We could put a break under all healthy to make it even more efficient. But you don't need to do that. In every, you literally just say, look, is every member healthy? We create a predicate function and say member is healthy. We then give that to every so they know how to determine if a person's healthy. It'll run that function on every single item. And if even one of them says false, it'll return false. Otherwise, if everyone turns true, it'll return true. So our party isn't healthy, so that's why it returns false. So we already talked about a predicate function. It's a function that always returns true or false, not throw, not undefined, not null, literally true or false. It's one of the most best pure functions because you can practice making total functions, which are pure functions that handle all inputs. Give an example of building predicates. Predicates are used to build other predicates. And this is also a wonderful example of how pure functions can be composed to build even larger pure functions. And this is kind of a glance at how you build programs in functional programming. You actually build functions that build bigger functions that build bigger functions. But because they're all pure and they're all have no side effects, and they're all deterministic, and they all require same input, same output, which makes them easier to unit test. They don't require mocks. Suddenly, you can see the value of creating programs out of pure functions because it's code that works. And that makes you feel really good. IsString is integer and get from Lodash. We're going to use his predicates first because he's battle-tested them. Has legit name, we're going to use it first because if we pass an undefined and we try to do a length, it's going to throw an error. So we say, hold on. Is it a string first? If the name property is a string, great. Let's make sure its length is greater than zero. So that way the user can't type empty string into the text field and hit submit. They have to type something for a name. Hit points. If the hit points are a number and they're greater than or equal to zero, we're not going to deal with negative numbers. We're not going to deal with undefined. If that's the case, then they are value. Now notice the bottom two handle two different properties. They handle hit points and max hit points. And this allows us to use that predicate to build higher level predicates. So if you look at the bottom there, legit hit points, we actually built predicates to use in other predicates. Again, this is a basic start to learning what the word compose means in functional programming. You're using these pure functions to build more pure functions, and you're composing them inside of each other, not composing them in pipes, which is what a lot of people usually refer to when they talk about composition. Every, we can use it with every. We put all those functions in the array, and you say, hey, look, does every single one of these predicates return true? And that way we can use it to validate, do we have a legit person or not? And now when we actually throw real objects at it, legit person can say, look, this is a legit person. The name's legit. The hit points are legit. Cool. The bottom one has a name, but it's missing hit points. And so that's going to return false. All right. This is the big one. So that's list comprehensions. We're going to talk about curry and partial applications. The whole point of curry is that every single function takes a single argument. But mostly we're not really using curried functions for the sake of curried functions. What we're interested in is partial applications. Dynamic languages, especially ones that take higher order functions and support closures. Closures are great. The problem is creating them is often done in an imperative way, which means they have outside effects. If you want partial applications, they're closures that are pure. And so we use curried functions to create partial applications or closures that are pure. Although we're focusing on currying and creating curried functions, which are all functions that are pure that take one argument, the end goal of doing all this is to get partial applications, which are reusable functions, reusable closures that are pure. That's why we're doing this. All functions take one argument that are pure. Great, but not all functions have one dependency. And that's one of the challenges with curried functions is that you end up having a lot of arguments of pure functions, which means your curried functions also tend to be very large as well. You have to declare dependencies in pure functions, which means that if I have a request module or something that does side effects, I have to declare it. The caveat is most people don't do their loggers. I do, but most people don't. If you do that, that results in a lot of arguments. Currying helps solve some of those, but not all of those. You disclose that curry and partial applications can be really, really hard without types. If you're IDE like Visual Studio Code, or if you're using WebStorm or NetBeans or Eclipse or whatever, if it doesn't have any type hints or any ability to kind of incense your code, even if it's dynamic and give you hints, maybe reading your JS doc comments above it, it can be really difficult to understand what the type parameters are. And a lot of the tooling around currying just is awful. It's just the way it is. It's very, very frustrating. Manual currying helps a lot of IDEs sometimes, but you just got to understand that if you're not going to use types, this is just going to be harder than it has to be. And that's just the way it is. You didn't do anything wrong. This is par for the course, okay? Why are we doing this again beyond what I said about partial applications? It can also shorten how many arguments a function requires, because if a lot of those arguments are already known ahead of time, then you can just create a partial application which has some of those arguments already pre-filled, and so your functions become shorter. You also sometimes can write less code using what's called point-free or point-free style. You can also create reusable functions from other functions, so we do that all the time with closures. But using partial applications, using curried functions, because curried functions create partial applications, then we can create reusable functions that way. Now, point-free style can be good or bad. It can be good in that point-free style is less code. It's a lot more less verbose than normal imperative coding and closures done manually, and they're pure. But they sometimes get to the point where you literally have functions that have no arguments, so you have no idea what to pass. And if you don't have types, it's kind of pointless. So that's where its name comes from. Instead of point free, they call it pointless programming. because it's stupid. It just depends on the day, depends on the user. In the German we all love, Dr. Axel here, he actually wrote about how currying is not idiomatic JavaScript, and he talks about a lot of the reasons that some of which apply to the things that I brought up, but he also has some wonderful other examples as well, and I encourage you to read why it's not considered idiomatic. I don't think there is such thing as idiomatic JavaScript. It's not like Python, which has rules. Just like Python, we literally invite anybody, OOP people, imperative people, Unix people, object-oriented people, functional programmers, whatever. We don't care who you are. It's considered very, very alien in JavaScript. And that's fine. I'm going to tell you how to do it anyway. We have a single function here. It has a single parameter. And we're just going to say, look, this is a basic predicate. Is it a string or not? Okay. So it only requires one parameter. And it's a pure function. But this one, getting data from server, needs the URL, but it also needs the request module. It has to define its outside dependencies. Otherwise, they can change and have outside effects, and this function is no longer pure. It could literally change at runtime what it returns, and that's not good. This one, if you're doing audit logging with Kafka, for example, has a ton of parameters, and I've actually written functions that are worse than this. So you can see that if you have to define your dependencies or anything that could affect the outside state, or in the case of, I need to know about the outside world, which means it has to come from function parameters, it basically means everyone getting the big old long line, right? If you want to be pure. So if you're getting on the train to Pure Land, sometimes the train is crowded. Let's talk about functionality real quick when we're dealing with function arguments. Functionality means how many arguments or parameters does a function take, right? When we say arguments, parameters, same thing. JavaScript, Python, Lua, they're all whack with this. They have a lot of neat features built around using that. And if you're going to go the curry route, you're going to say, I don't want to use those features. I think those features are either not useful or they violate purity or they're just dangerous to purity. And the third one is it's important to know what arity means, because when we talk about curry and partial applications, the amount of parameters, the number is extremely important. There's no longer a concept of what they call variadic functions or dynamically amount of parameters or rest-based functions where you have like one, like zero parameters or one parameter or 20. That add function I showed earlier, that goes away. When we talk about arity, we need to know how many parameters does this function take. This case is always true. It's one of the best pure functions. It's literally impossible to break. Even if you futz around with prototype, you can't break it. A great example of why pure functions are awesome, because you can't break it. But notice that it doesn't have any parameters. So we same input, same output, we always call it, but it has no parameters. Sup takes one. And so this is an example where if I pass in a single parameter, I get a parameter back. So if I call name, it'll log out the name. In this case, it takes two. So again, zero arity, one arity, right? It takes one parameter name. Load website takes two. So an arity of two. Okay, you can tell by the comma. But the arity property can actually be checked by doing the length. So not just arrays, but functions have a length property. And the length property for functions applies to how many arguments they take. So in a case of function declarations, you can do dot length. It shows this one of zero. Function expressions, they also have a length property. In this case, it's one because we're taking a function of name. And arrow functions, they too have an arity property. In this case, two. Arrow functions, function declarations, function expressions, they all support the arity. But this is where it starts to break down. When you have default arguments, and we set it to the second one, it'll say the arity is one, even though it technically takes two. And the reason is that you don't have to supply the second one. If you supply the first, the function will still work. If you imagine JavaScript looking like the right here, where it says URL equals job, like jessewarren.com, but replace that with undefined. Every single parameter that you name in a function in JavaScript actually defaults to undefined. So if you don't pass it, it'll literally say, well, I guess URL is undefined. In this case, we're giving it a value. That's why it considers that one. It's like, well, I guess you don't need it. Although we didn't pass the second parameter for load website on the second example, it technically did. It counted as undefined, right? And so that's how they both return promises. They both work. They both, you know, load a website through a HTTP module, in this case, a request. But only one of those parameters is required. If you put it in the front, JavaScript basically stops counting. Although the second one is required, it says no arguments are required, which is completely bonkers. Functions returning functions may be a new concept. I'm not going to go into a little of this. I'm assuming if you know JavaScript, you know Lua and Python, this is a very common thing for you. But just to give you a few examples, the debug module in Node, my man Steve Husak hooked me up with this. It's a very common way to debug in Node code. And you can configure it with environmental variables. It makes things really pretty. It's really, really, really helpful way of logging. Better console, basically. But notice the top. It is a function that returns a function, and then you call it. So we call it twice. Require debug, but then we immediately call it with HTTP. Prefix it so when it logs out to the screen, we have HTTP in front of it. So look at the bottom, we have a function, that debug function. So require returns a function, we call it with HTTP, but then we get debug, which is another function. Very common use of functions, return functions. But none of this has anything to do with functional programming. It's just a normal feature of JavaScript or dynamic languages that return functions. We talk about React, you have debounce function. Debounce takes your function and gives you another function that makes sure your original function isn't called too much. You don't want to call too fast. If you're typing, you don't want it to constantly filter if the list is large. You want to slow it down a bit. So only refilter the list every half a second. So that way the user can type, the JavaScript doesn't overload their ability to actually fight with, you know, how fast they can type their keyboard. And a function that returns a function. Common, normal prior art, you're using it all the time. So it's not a new concept, but it has nothing to do with function programming. It's just a normal feature. So let's teach you how to manually query first, and then I'll show you some of the styles that are around there. Doing manual querying so we can create partial applications. So let's learn how to do it first, and then I'll show you some examples of partial application usage. So we have a closure here, and we load a website, you give it a URL, it'll make an HTTP call and give you the data back, whatever HTML is on that page. The problem with this is that that request is not sure. It's not coming, the outside world is not coming in through the function arguments. So this is a closure, common, normal thing to do in JavaScript, but it's not a pure closure. It's not a pure function because of that request. So the way you fix it is you do what a pure function does, declares dependencies. And so we put it as the first argument, and we say, there you go. So now when we call it, we require the request module, load it in as the first parameter, and the function works as normal. The only difference is now it requires two parameters instead of one, but at least it's pure, right? And so for unit test, we'd give it a fake request. Manually querying, instead of doing a comma, we literally have a function that returns a function, just like we talked about. I usually don't put parentheses around single argument in JavaScript, but in this case, I'm doing it to illustrate the point here, is that instead of request comma, we're doing request, which is a function, returns a UL, returns a function. If you think about manual querying is literally just turning the commas into fat arrows, that's really all it's about. Turning the commas into fat arrows. That's how you manually query. You turn this into the bottom, okay? Now, every single function takes one parameter. You've thus got a queried function. If you print it out, if we were to print out the partial application it sends back, and we call load website with just request, it's going to give us the function back, right? And if we print it out and print out what the, you can see it's a function, just like we had before. It takes a URL, loads a request, and the request is not in there. Notice how it only takes for URLs one parameter. What's going on? How is it a pure function? Well, it's in the closure. So remember, we pass it in up here in the request, right? So it's part of the closure. So this is where using closures in a pure way is okay. This new function call who dis, that is what we call a partial application. It is a function with some of its arguments applied or partially applied. The request is applied and it's the closure right there. If you see request.get, it's already there in that function ready to go in the closure. It's going to be there, but the URL, we're waiting on the user to call the function again with the URL. That's what we mean by partially applied. It's almost going to execute. Almost. It just needs one more. That's when we talk about queried functions. The last argument kicks it off. In this case, URL would be the last argument. Request the first, nothing happens. It literally just gives you a function back. Once we call that with a URL, we get the promise back, right? And so that kicked it off. The top shows the old way. You'll just call request as a pure function. The second parameter is the URL. In the bottom, we call it the same way. We just invoke the function in line that calls back. That's all. So instead of comma, a function takes two parameters. Queried functions, every single function takes one parameter. So you just call it like this. So this is where people hate manual querying in JavaScript. It makes it non-idiomatic. I can never pronounce that word. But it starts to look like Lisp because you have parentheses everywhere or closure. It's pretty bad. Let's talk about closures again, just to get a refresher. Again, this one is not pure because it's using the closure. And so the way we make it pure is we put the request or the dependency in there. And that way you're forced to import it. You could wrap it again, right? You could wrap your pure function with a closure. But again, this function, this load website with request is not pure, because he doesn't declare his dependency. So this is where querying makes it pure. One of the great things about closures is that the item in there is private. You can't mess with it. This closure you can mess with. You can completely mess with that request at the very top there and change it to something else like in your unit test. And you've made the load website with request function completely impure because you modified that closure it used. Whereas queried, once you're inside the closure, you can't normally mess with things inside the closure. So it's pure in that respect. Top, import request. In this case, we have an impure function, like the load website with request. But notice the bottom one, if we use the queried version, we call request with it. And at this point, it's just waiting on you to do the URL. This is where parcel applications created with Curry require a lot less code. Both of these functions do the exact same thing. The only difference is the bottom is Curry and it's pure. The top, the one in the middle here, load website with request, it's not pure and it's not Curry. Now load website's pure, but because the function in useDim is not pure, it breaks everything. One or zero arguments are weird. You can't make Curry functions where the function takes one argument or no arguments because the last one makes it do things. This load website request is partial application, but that last argument, the URL, makes it do, makes it go. So there's no way to make it Curry. The rule of Curry functions, you make them, is to put knowns and unknowns in certain orders. So when we talk about knowns, we mean known knowns, like things we know are probably going to be a known module we're going to use. Where unknowns, we have no idea what URL you're going to use. So what I mean, if you're going to make a REST call in Node, you're going to use HTTP, request, or Axios. Like that, it's just known. That's what you do in Node. If you're in the browser, you can use Fetch or Polyfill if you're using old browsers. Or Axios, right? You're going to use one of these libraries. Those are what we mean by knowns. Unknowns are the things that we don't know, like the URL. So the order was left the knowns, right the unknowns, left to right. Left is where static dependencies like the HTTP modules we know we're going to use. Right is the dynamic data. In case of a browser, we import fetch, we're going to put it to the left in the URL. So we know in the browser we're going to use fetch, right? Or cross-fetch the polyfill. Either way, we know it's going to be left, so we always put that first. But the unknown, the URL, we have no idea. And the reason is that you can expose that partial application at the very, very bottom there, load JSON with fetch, because we know that you're going to do it. The only thing that's dynamic down here is the URL. So even with the curried function at the bottom, or the closure we did up top, load JSON with fetch, what's dynamic? The URL, because we know the fetch. So these creating of partial applications, these creating of concretes that we know we're going to do, there's no need for the user to supply fetch. We can do that for them, right, in a pure function. But on the bottom, it's pure and it's less code. So that's why Curry's really nice for that. When you talk about known being fetch and unknown being URL, what happens if we reverse it? this is where the rule really comes to light, where you really understand, oh, I get it. So we put URL first, the dynamic to the left, and the known to the right. Watch what happens when we try to do a closure. Works just fine, right? We don't really care. Parameter order doesn't matter. The fetch is literally just walking outside the function and going to the outside world to get it from the closure. But what happens when you deal with Curry? Well, that doesn't really work because if you curry the URL with the URL you know, what are you going to put for the fetch? Like you can't because it's not there, right? So it doesn't really work. So this is why closures are a little easier. Encouraged functions break down when you don't have the concretes to the left. Partial applications, what are they good for? You don't have a choice what curly functions return. But partial applications help you create reusable code. They help you create pure closures, okay? They can help in debugging too. They can also reduce the number of arguments you have to do. In our examples, we went from 2 to 1, but a lot of other ones, you'll have a bunch of common modules and you'll put those up front. You'll just expose them for unit tests if you need to stub things, for example. Exposing public APIs. You're going to expose the concretes already built in. You're not going to expose the curried functions. You're going to expose the partial ones. For an example, in this case, we have a load website. We're only going to expose the I'm a partial application. We're not going to expose the website because we already know the request. We're not going to force them to import their own request. It's stupid. And again, this is just an example of creating functions that return functions, right? We've done this before. No big deal. If you're creating a polyfill, another example, I'm going to load a JSON, and internally in the function, if the browser supports fetch, I'm going to use the polyfill, otherwise not, right? So this is where you can create partials yourself, right? You're creating partially applied arguments. There are cases where you may want to create partial applications from a function that has zero or no arguments. Well, you can't do it if you can't curry. So what do you do? Well, there's functions called partial, which basically create pure closures with 0, 1 arguments, which is kind of cool. Case of ping, I just want to load a website and I want to call request and localhost ping in a unit test or an integration test in this case. But I don't want to have to supply those arguments every time, right? I want to create a reusable function. Partial applications are just that, they're reusable functions. So I can use a closure like I did up top and say load website, or I can use partial, which allows me to create a pure closure, a pure function. I say ping, I want it to be the load website function. Can you please give it these 2 parameters? And voila, it returns back a pure function. So the ping up top, you can break that by changing request. Where ping, you can't change that because once it's created, it no longer can be changed. It's an immutable function. It can't have its request dynamically change at runtime. Do the same thing where you create it yourself. On the bottom, where I have load JSON again, where they put the dynamic stuff to the left, you can actually fix it with something called partial write. So in this case, partial write, I could say, all right, since they broke it, they put the dynamic stuff to the left. we can say, all right, put the things we know ahead of time to the right. And so we've got a partial function. We're just waiting for, in this case, the URL. So that's kind of how you can fix the people who don't follow curry rules of known to the left and unknowns to the right. Let's talk about the styles of curry. You don't have to do everything manually. There could be third-party code you don't own. Majority of JavaScript is not written in a curried fashion. Pretty much anything in known modules. Code you've already written. Could be code you've written in the past. It's useful. You want to use, but you'd like to use curry. Or maybe you're a beginner or working with beginners. And you want to expose public functions that people won't know what the heck, why they're getting a function back when they accidentally supply what they thought were default arguments, right? And they get this function back. They go, I don't understand. There's certain styles that can make learning curry easier and exposing public APIs easier for developers. The four libraries I'm going to talk about are Lodash, Romda, Folktale, and Sanctuary. They all provide a version of curry. Lodash is cool because you can take an existing function, literally say curry, done, it's curry. And the even cooler thing about it is that it works with partial applications, right? Just like you would before. But you can call it with any style you want. You can do it the Lisp style. You can do it, you know, curry style, where every function takes one parameter. You can do it normal style, like in JavaScript number 2, where you have comma, comma, comma. Or you can do it a hybrid style at the bottom. So you can do one parameter or two. Now, normally I like to do it like this, but not everyone likes to do it like that. Lodash and Folktale both have a weird arity, though. And the reason arity is important is some frameworks care about it. So, for example, Express or Restify or a lot of others, Node middlewares, if they have 3 parameters, it's a route. If they have 4, it's an error handler. If you put Lodash or Folktale curried functions in there, it breaks. Can't make error handlers this way. You have to violate curry to do that. Folktale and Lodash both report 0 on that curried function, which is, I think, wrong because they do, you know, require parameters. Sanctuary is technically correct. If you have a function that has an arity of 2 and you use the curry 2 function from Sanctuary, it'll do a length of 1, which is technically true because all curried functions require one argument. That's not useful. Well, mathematically correct, it's not useful. Romda is the only one that's useful. Romda says, all right, look, I'll take your function. I'll remember what the arity is, but I'll follow the curried function rules of all functions require the thing. But again, it supports the Lodash style. We can do commas as well. So in conclusion, pure functions, we know what those are. They're basically the precept, the common of all functional programming. You understand pure functions. You understand everything. You understand lenses, list comprehensions, curry, partial applications. Lenses are only used to do pure things in dynamic languages. Type languages, compilers help you get around this. Least comprehensions, it's just a way to do loops that are pure. Currying and partial applications, you make curried functions so you can more easily create partial applications or functions that have some of their arguments already in there. They're closures that are pure. So when we talk about pure functions, we mean the two rules, same input, same output, and no side effects. And the challenge with pure functions doing themselves, they have to declare their dependencies and their arguments, both for unit testing and for runtime purity. Now, there are levels of purity, okay? You got to determine what's good for you and your team. To give you an example, Redux Thunk, you're using a Redux, you're pure, right? Well, not necessarily. Promises, although you can guarantee that a function always returns a promise, promises hide side effects, right? They're monads that hide side effects. And so when you think about Redux Thunk, you technically have state in your UI. Now, I'm cool with that because I'm okay with that level of impurity. But some people want no side effects in their UI. And so they use Redux Saga, and that guarantees that your UI literally has no side effects, which is amazing from a purity perspective. It just requires more work. For example, when we talk about UI levels of purity, are you okay with being pragmatic and saying, look, I'm going to use classes for React. That's fine. I'm just going to stay away. But here we have an example of a React component, a counter. When you click these buttons, it increments and decrements the internal state. It sets this. It has internal state, right? It's kind of built into React, right? Or do you want to use pure functions? If you're using something like Recompose, it allows you to write pure functions for your React code. So just an example of doing UI development in a pure way. Very, very hard. It's a lot easier to do functional code in a server than it is to do in the browser or in any front end, really. Unity, Pixie.js, doesn't matter. And in conclusion, for lenses, you got to avoid the dots. Use get or set. This guarantees you won't break things. I can't help your variable misspellings, but that's why we have things like ESLint and unit tests. Using lens and Romda is when you want to use it in loops. If you're going to start doing a lot of modification on deeply nested data or reading or whatever, that's where lens and Romda, the lens functions help out a lot. And list comprehensions, again, they're just pure functions for loops. The big three is really all you care about is map, filter, reduce. The shorter code, no state, no errors, pure. So if you like pure functions, we want to do with loops. That's the big three can help you out. When we talk about currying and partial applications, we're talking about all functions take one argument. The goal is to create partial applications. Known static parameters to the left or unknown dynamic things, variables we don't know, the user is going to supply to the right. Lodash, Ramda, Folktale, Sanctuary, they all have wonderful curry and partial functions that help beginners. So you can write code as normal, but it's curried. So you can start to see the benefits of curry and partial applications without like diving all in and doing manual curry all over the place, which can be extremely alien and hard to work with for some code bases. So that's it. That's Functional Programming, a Beginner's Guide. Hope that was helpful. And I encourage you to check out my algebraic data types with Folktale, Fun with Folktale. It's a video that talks about the ADT portion of this. We've talked mostly about pure functions, curried functions, but we never actually talked about the types that you can use that are like kind of like enhanced classes, but more functional in nature. And they have a lot of useful features that help in functional programming, but they're pure, right? They're pure ISK kind of types. So you should definitely check that out. So if you got any other questions, let me know. You can contact me on Twitter, LinkedIn, things like that. And here's all the links to Lodash and Ramda, Folktale and Sanctuary. The Folktale docs occasionally change. Just use link to version docs. Lodash will automatically take you to the latest version docs. I hope that was helpful. Thanks for your time.